Hello, you guys can hear me? All right, I'm live, guys. Sorry about that. Once again, it's Nathaniel Evans from I Am The Data. I focus on leadership and spirituality. And, you know, this is the time right now where we, you know, looking for this change in ourselves, you know, and looking to find, like, who we really are and what really makes us tick in this life. And it's just so much that's going on that a lot of time that we forget to, you know, really be ourselves and really focus on the things that really matter, right? And this is what makes everything so purposeful. It's actually looking at the things that actually matter in our lives. Like, you know, we can get focused on things that can be the purpose of who we are. We can get focused on careers, you know, ideologies, you know, even religions and certain things of that nature. We might only identify ourselves according to the Bible, or maybe even according to Quran, or maybe even just according to currencies that's actually out here that a lot of people are investing their lives into, is in the power of currency, right? So now we're looking at the dynamics of when those things that were once important to you are no longer important to you. What do you do? When those things you can focus all your time and all your energy, all your substance to building, did not come back to build you. I'm saying, what do you do? And how do you do it? You see? Yeah, what do you do? How do you do it? You know what I'm saying? So when we're looking at the topic that we actually have today, the power of the shift, what does that mean? What does the power of the shift actually means to us as individuals? How do we shift out of spaces that we actually been stuck in for a very long time? Right? So it's just things that we actually create, and we actually get stuck in those things that we created. And when it's time for us to make a power shift, we don't know which way to go. We don't know if we're going to go to the right. We don't know if we're going to the left, up or down. We might even know what friends to talk to, or potential friends, or even associates that we can actually go to help us with this power shift, right? We live in a pitch-perfect utopia world, right, that nobody really believes in, but also want to portray, right? No one has a pitch-perfect life. When you go outside, a person got the best suit on, best hat, best skirt, best shoes, you know, they got the best car, they're drinking the best coffee, they got the best pair of headphones on, and things of that nature. You're looking at a pitch-perfect carbon copy of a life, right? People, you go and watch the movie, you say, well, my life is not like that. You know, you go watch a play and say, oh my God, I was expressing the same thing and no one listens to me, right? The power of the shift, right, is knowing how you're going to shift. That's the power of the shift. It's understanding that the shift is not an easy shift. Right? It is not something you can just say, you know what, I'm going to make a shift and the shift is just going to take place and everything is just copacetic, so to speak. Right? It's just going to be a natural thing. Like, for instance, if an individual right now was making a six-figure job and that, you know, making a six-figure salary at a job and an individual was fired, how did that individual basically come back from being fired from a six-figure job? How did they do it? If that individual was working, right, and paying mortgage and paying car note and paying for people to go to school and buying all type of trinkets, or actually was the Uber man, you know what I mean, or Uber Eats man and stuff like that, and you could spend $300 on Uber Eats and things of that nature, right? If this person was subjected to this type of lifestyle, actually building this type of life and actually building this type of model, how did this person continue to build such a model without the essential tools and resources that they relied on to continue building that? If the person is not able to continue to build on this this fantasy island lifestyle, so to speak, like where nothing's going to go wrong ever, like it's just a perfect life, like I've never had a hardship and I never even screamed or yelled at anybody ever in my life. Like if a person comes into that type of concept and now all of a sudden they got to start screaming, yelling at people, they're failing now, They, you know, they're behind on their payments, and this never happened before. Now the fantasy island life is gone. Right now we're dealing with real life now. Like, how do that person still have their dignity, still have their purpose, still have the value for who they are without having those things that value who they were? Those things that actually come your value. If you making six figures, you know mad people. Mad people know you, bro. They calling you for donations. They calling you for fundraisers. They calling you when their lights and gas get turned off, when they don't have no money for their rent. They contacting you for all type of things because you're the one that making six figures. Everybody else is making five figures. You making six. You the man. They coming for you. When I say the man, I just mean man and woman. Don't get it. Don't get technical, right? We talking about person itself. Once you start achieving these different things and you know, breaking through barriers that other people are not able to break through, you know, all of a sudden you're the barrier breaker. You're the barrier breaker not only for your life, but also for the lives of other people. They're looking to you to help them break through barriers. Why? Because how else are they going to learn? If you don't sit down and teach them how to break through barriers, it speaks about all the barriers that you broke and all the changes that you have made in the world, and not teach them how to break through barriers and bring forth those same changes in their lives. That's kind of strange, right? That they would have to come to you for that, that you need to come to them and actually give it to them so they can actually build and grow. It's amazing that they would have to come to you to get the answers for a barrier that you broke that all humanity is trying to break. We all trying to break the barrier of peace. We all trying to break the barrier of finances. We all trying to break the barrier of solidarity. We all trying to break the barrier of having a great community. We all trying to break the barrier of exquisite education that's going to take me to Yale, Harvard, Spelman, all those different things. We all trying to break those same barriers, bro. You're not the only one trying to break that barrier. All of us are trying to do the same thing. So when you break the barrier, you said you was my friend before you broke the barrier, and you don't come back to me as a friend to show me how to break the barrier, then you actually was never my friend. Friends help friends break barriers and bring forth change. Friends make sure that friends do not fall into the darkness of the land, because this land is full of darkness. If I turn on the news, it's all darkness. Most of the movies that's on here is all darkness. Even the comedy is darkness. Even the cartoons, you can find mad darkness in their cartoons. Right? So this is exquisite to understand this. As you're going through this power shift, know who's a part of you, man. Know who's a part of that shift. You know what I'm saying? Know what joysticks you can actually, you know what I'm saying, maneuver and actually carry around on land. Know what people that's always going to say, hey, man, this path right here been hitting, and I hit it for you. You know what I'm saying? Now you can walk on this path, and I'm going to show you how to maneuver through the land. If you don't have that, a part of your power shift, then something's going to be wrong with your picture, man. You're going to be trying to do all these different things to keep yourself afloat. You know what I'm saying? To strategize, to create a foundation. But you can't because you don't know which way you hold the shift. You know who you're supposed to shift into, right? Who has loving arms, you know what I'm saying, so you fall into like a pillow? Who has it for you? Who's in the world for you, you know what I'm saying, to embrace you in your darkest hour? Which person is there? Oh, I'm telling you, man, this is amazing because you're going to find mad people when you're in the light. When you're in the light, mad people are going to find you, bro. You ain't got to do nothing. They always see the candlestick hitting under the bush. They see it already. They're actually going to come find it and start moving the bush and say, who lit that candlestick? We need to find who lit that candlestick, right? Because we're all on the same path. We all want to be happy. We all want to be content. We all want to be at peace. We all want to find life. We all want to know what life is. And we all want to be connected to others that say they're connected to us in a loving embrace. The power shift is who we are in our real times and our real moments. And as we shift to the right and as we shift to the left, right, we're going to find out who's in the space of our power. You're going to find who that person is. You're going to find out if it's going to be a friend. Is it going to be a stranger? Is it going to be people that you poured into continuously and see who pulls back into you? Is it going to be one of your coworkers? Is it going to be the bus driver? Like, who's going to be here to help you when it's time for you to need help? Because you out helping everybody. You're on everybody's radar. Everybody calls you for everything, man. I need somebody to talk to. Such and such will listen. I need some money. Such and such will lend it to me. I need this. Let me go to such and such and such and such and such and such for all these different things. But now with your model, this model you created, this model of so-called perfection, this model of so-called, you know, I can never get anything wrong and I'm invincible. Well, people are going to try that out. They're going to find out if you're invincible. They're going to find out if you're not going to fall. They're going to find out if you're actually the go-to person when it's time for them to not understand what's happening in their own lives. They're actually going to come to you for those different things, right? And when it comes to you, you got to realize, did you make yourself a model of change, right? Did you tell people directly or indirectly you're going to assist them and their growth and development when they were assisting you and your growth and development? Or did you forget about those things when those things actually, when it came around full circle, actually bring forth that power? So we spoke about dealing with people, right, and making this power shift. And this power shift has one purpose: to increase you. As you're going through this power shift, it's only to increase you. It's only to enlighten you according to your true purpose and your true nature. And actually, what's around your true purpose and what's around your true nature. People can say, hey, you know, I love you. I care for you. You know what I'm saying? You're the best thing since sliced bread, right? And when catastrophes start hitting your life, people start scattering, basically like roaches, so to speak, right? And that's a weird analogy, but that's basically what happened. The lights turn on according to your darkness and nobody's around. They all disappear, right? When you was in your light, now people know your phone number, your email, they was in your inbox on social media, all different type of things was taking place, right? Through the power shift. And, you know, once if you needed help to come to actually fulfill your power shift, to actually come in to the momentum and that power of your power shift, you just need a little pull. No one's there for you. No one's there to pull you out. No one's there to encourage you, to give you great substance of motivation. I'm saying nobody sees your true light and your true purpose of who you are and what you actually bring to the table. They're looking at pessimistic things about who you are. They're looking at the stumbling blocks of who you are. But I'm going to tell you something. I learned this in prison, bro. This is something I learned in prison. And it's for everybody to understand this, man. When you're in prison, certain people that have certain crimes are pinpointed by the administration because they want the people that's in prison to acknowledge prison itself. How do you get prisoners to acknowledge the value of prison, the inside of prison? What you do is you create a crime inside the prison. You announce a crime inside the prison that they would not be able to associate with, like a rape or something like that, a rape of a little kid. He raped a five-year-old and you put him in population. It's an uproar. People in there, they want to hurt the person. They think about their own sons and daughters. Maybe that could have been my son and daughter. They play these psychological games against you to make you agree to the concept of a prison environment. These things that they have created in these planes have been created on purpose. There's no misunderstanding. There is no mishap about any of these structures that have actually been taking place. Even the structure of man not helping man and not building man is also a structure that has actually been created. When you go into the other nations, besides the African-American or so-called African-American or Black nation, the other nations work in solidarity. Right? Three people are split a hero and they all be content. Me, I got to get a hero by myself and watch other people starve. That's what we do in this land. This is what we do according to the African-American so-called Black people, according to our synergy and who we are supposed to be as a people. Right? So, with that being said, when it's time for us actually as a people to shift, where do we shift into, or we cannot shift into one another? About four. And I can't fall into my own nation, then where do I fall? Because no other nation acknowledges me. They don't smile at me when they see me in the street. They don't dance with me when they see me in the street. They don't kiss me on the cheek. They don't tell me that it's amazing that me, as well as them, was actually to get here as a life force to be on the same plane. There's no praise and there's no worship. You know what I'm saying? There's, you know what I mean? There's no amazing excitement that we're all here on this plane. and that we all got here together. That's amazing, bro. Right? I was watching a movie the other day, and it would show two monkeys, right? And one monkey, he was inside the whole time. He never came out. But the other monkey, they was already outside. They already knew what it is to be outside. So when it's time for the other monkey to come outside for the first time, they grabbed them, they hugged them, they kissed them, they pat them on the back, they walked them to the new space that they've been hanging out with. They gave them a whole rundown of everything they was doing as monkeys. But man can't do this for some reason at certain particular times amongst one another, right? We have, what you would say, a responsibility to assist one another and our power shift. When we go into a space of darkness, there are others that's supposed to assist in the space of darkness because we helped them when they was in space of darkness to come into a space of light. But they forgot about those spaces. They forgot about those times that we was in those space of darkness for them while we had a little light on us and shed our light in their darkness so they can now see. See, this is what it is. When your light is not being shined, you know what I'm saying, to space that you say you care about, and when light is not being shined into spaces of you from others that say they also care about that space that you care about, then it's time for you to actually look at this power shift and shift out of this space, because this space is not cultivating you, right? We're not here to be known by these people or be known by that person or be worshipped by this or by this. All these different things that they actually have us out here worshiping and actually these things that we adhere to, they're meaningless. No, there's no story that any man has actually followed while he was alive and he's able to come back to us and tell us that it was the truth. There was no story. The closest I ever heard of that somebody said, somebody came to me in a dream and told me this. Yeah, okay. Yeah, I had dreams too. Like, people told me stuff in dreams too. I didn't believe everything people told me in dreams, right? And I'm not a dream catcher, right? So we're not going to play, we don't analyze dreams and stuff like that. We're talking about real life, real person who came back to you and told you what you was following was absolutely true, and that you have could do no wrong, and that you have already filled up the bottle of righteousness, so you could just do all type of wickedness you want, and your bottle of righteousness is never going to basically disappear. It's always going to be there because you stored up a bottle of righteousness that no man can touch, hear, see, or smell, and you're perfect in the land. Who told you this? Right? We have these tall tales that's coming out the Bibles. They come out the Quran. They're coming out the Hindu books. They're coming from all over about man telling stories about things he know not. Right? The power of who we are has nothing to do with what you think you know or what you think you don't know. The power of who we are is who we are. And what people see within us, and they see our power, and yeah, not all of us have been able to cultivate that and bring that to the forefront on a high frequency. Not all of us. And for those of us that believe that we are supposed to be these iconic figures, and we're supposed to be the utopian processes out here to bring forth change without actually being poured into and not actually being basically created, you know what I'm saying? Or basically even built into, is impossible, right? There will be no Malcolm X. There will be no Martin Luther King. Other people did not pour into those people's lives. Malcolm X made a lot of mistakes. Yeah, he came from a dark period in his life, and he came and went back into another space that also seemed like it's a dark period too, but it was a religion. But it was a dark space, but it seemed like it was a religious space, but it came actually turned out to be a dark space for him. And he actually lost his life in that dark space. Would it supposed to have been a light for him, but it actually didn't turn out to be a light for him according to his legacy. We don't even got a Malcolm X holiday. Like that's how powerful that is. We got a Martin Luther King holiday, but we don't got a Malcolm X holiday. And this is how profound that society's actually taught us the lessons of actually standing up for yourself. What it means to stand up for yourself in this world. What it means to come into your true power shift. What it means to isolate you and to bring you to a new plateau. What it means in this world. It means you become an endangered species. The more you get into coming into your power, the more things around you separate themselves from you because they're no longer associated to the power of who you are, right? Who we are shifts all the time, every day, all day. We're always shifting. What you did 10 minutes ago, you might not do 10 minutes later. this is how life moves, right? And we're in a continuous process to actually finding that solution to actually allow us to stand strong, you know what I'm saying, through all things as individuals, but also as collective beings, right? A man that says he's struggling in the land is a man that has no friends. That's the man that struggles in the land, a man that has no friends, the woman that has no friends, the person that actually achieves something and to say, I don't need no one because I got everything I need for myself. And then the thing that they achieve dissolves like everything else in the world dissolves, right? And now all of a sudden you have no more friends, right? It's about being really careful about what you put your power in. The power shift is not just about power. It's not just about shifting. It's about knowing what that power is and what that shift is and how to put those two together so you can do what you need to do and move forward. That's what the power shift is about. It's about you finding you in real time, but also finding you within others in real time so y'all can increase each other in real time according to the true power of one another. To see the power of one another as you transition into the land and to know that the power of you also exists in the land somewhere else. So the working model that you're working on to bring forth change, whatever you do in the land, you're not doing this alone. It's just like Walmart. Walmart didn't come. Sam Walton didn't just say, hey, I'm just building Walmart for myself and it's going to be my business. No, Sam Walton went around and created contracts and partnerships all over the world. Not only did he do that, he had sons and daughters, and he brought them into the land and brought them into the business. He brought his nieces and his nephews into the business, his grandsons, his granddaughters into the business. Why you think Walmart is a major conglomerate in the land? Because he understood the power of change, and the power of change for Sam Walton was collectivity. That's what it was. His whole model of selling products was about collectivity. How to get more products to the people under less value. Connectivity. The mom and pop store is not connecting with 90% of the community. They only connecting with 40% of the community. How do me connect with 90% of the community? I'm gonna create products and services that 90% of the community will need at a very, very noon price. That's how I'm going to do it. I'm going to wipe out the mom and pop store at the same time that I'm creating this level of connectivity to my social environment. People want to save money. This is what Sam Walton said. They don't want to spend a whole bunch of money on stuff. They want to take 5 cents and get four things instead of taking 5 cents and getting one thing. Connectivity, how to connect and serve other people while they also serving you. It's the power of the shift. Sam Walton wasn't born. He was born Sam Walton, but he wasn't born the owner of Walmart. He created this. It didn't come out of nowhere. It didn't come out of thin air. This is something that was created, that was magnified, that was increased, right? Every system that we actually create in this land has to be magnified and has to be increased. If it's not magnified and increased, if we're not increasing one another as brothers and sisters, if we're not increasing each other as advocates, we're not increasing each other as leaders, right? We're not increasing each other as workers. Then there's no point in connecting to these spaces when these spaces need increase in order to survive. Everything that a man does, he believes that's important. He believes it's the most important thing in the world. But it's important for him. It's not important for the whole world. And when that man finds himself in a selected place in the world, that man or woman, they want to be cultivated in that space because they could have chose a million other spaces to be in, but they chose that space. So the people that's in those spaces need to understand the blessings of people coming into their space, of coming into their world, of coming into their life, of directly or indirectly helping them with their purpose, because they helping you with your power shift. Don't ever think that your power shift is greater than another man's power shift. Don't ever think that your purpose is greater than another man's purpose, or the things you have is going to make you greater than another man. Yeah, you might go buy a condo and then the condo get bombed and you die in a condo. Nobody want to be in a condo now. Nobody want to take your place in a condo, right? So no one cares about any of those things. You know what I'm saying? It's about building each other. We can keep building bricks all we want to. The earth is going to keep producing what it's supposed to produce, the earth. You're going to go on the earth. You're going to take out dirt. You're going to turn into bricks, other substances, and that's it. The earth is going to keep producing what it produces. But how do we produce one another? That's what I want to know. How, when you go in a room, it's not one leader, but 50 leaders. How do we do that? How do we get to the point where we don't look up to you and you don't look up to me, or we look at the problem at hand and we dissolve the problem? How do we get to that point right there? Right, because at the end of the game, at the end of the day, you expect for me to actually be a part of something that's not a part of me. So, all right. So, let's get this straight. I'm kind of confused now, right? So you're trying to tell me that the engine that's in the car that everybody loves, they love to drive this car around and whatever they, for whatever reason, you're trying to tell me this engine right here that has all this power. You're trying to tell me that's one component in the engine that doesn't work and that's in it for no reason. Is that what you're saying? Because when men and women come around and connect with each other, they're the engine. You ain't realize that? When the men and women come together for one purpose to address the issue, they are the engine. And every component of that engine must be cultivated. It must be lubricated. Time and care must be placed on that one component of the engine, or you would run into a tree when the engine shut down and stalled in the middle of the road. Or you get hit by a tractor trailer or some other type of weird thing that's taking place in the land. We are the engines for one another's changes. There is no big I'm little yous. And there's a whole bunch of big I'm little yous in so many different spaces in life that put the brain forth change and put the magnify man. But man becomes magnified by things and not by him. He get locked in according to things and systems. Like my professor used to say all the time, system, 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 Nathaniel. It's all about system, Nathaniel. Look at the system, Nathaniel. And I never understood what he was talking about. But I understand now because I'm in the thick of it. I'm in the advocacy space. I'm in the reentry space. I'm in the nonprofit spaces. I'm in the motivational speaking spaces, right? I'm in these different spaces. And you get to see what's really happening. I done asked many leaders to come on my podcast that's in those spaces that I'm in with them. And I've been in those spaces for many years with these individuals. They won't come on my podcast to speak about their change. The power shift. Why? Why won't it come into the podcast? Why won't it come into the change? So you got to understand that when you go into spaces, understand and make sure that the spaces also is going into you, man. Make sure it's also resonating with you. Make sure that you can increase according to the spaces that you actually link yourself in, or you're going to lose the power of your shift. You don't want to lose the power of your shit. When you create a change, when you create a new momentum, you want to run like horses, man. You don't want nothing to hold you back. You don't want nothing to tame you. You don't want nothing that nobody could control you. You want to be according to your true purpose of what your life actually means. Right? At the end of the day, you don't want to be connected to different things. Right? So when we in these different things that we're doing in our lives, right, we want to bring our power to those things. When we connect with others that's in the land, we want to make sure that these individuals have our power in mind. There's no reason why an individual going to an advocacy event or going to a nonprofit or any different places and don't feel fulfilled, don't feel empowered, don't feel motivated to continue to bring forth change. Instead of helping 1,000 people, they're gonna help 10,000. Instead of helping 10,000 people, they're gonna help 100,000 and so forth and so forth. Why? Because this is the space of being cultivated. This is when you know that they're being cultivated, right? And because they're being cultivated, they're going to cultivate you. They're going to cultivate anyone that's cultivating them. Anyone's associated to the cultivation of them, they're going to put their energy and their power into those spaces. Right? It's all about the darkest hours that I see all the time. When you talk about Christ and you talk about all these leaders that came into the land, they came into the land in our darkest hours. They did not come into the land in our lightest hours. We were not on cloud 9. We did not rule governments and things of that thing. We're being ruled over and dominating the land. They came in our darkest hours to cure us, to reprove us, to renew us, and to befriend us, man. The people that's in our inner circles, if this is not their motive, if this is not their agenda, we need to find out what it is, right? When you go into a space, you're supposed to come out better than when you went in. And it doesn't matter what space that is. We're living in a time right now where people are focusing on a lot of things to bring forth comfort. The more money you have, the more things you have, the more prominent you are, the more people look up to you and value. If I was, and you know, I was a value, basically value podcaster, I would have to ask certain people to come to the podcast. They say, hey, I want to come on your podcast. Today. I see what you're doing because I got 1.2 million followers and things that I need on my podcast. So now it's an incentive for you to come into my podcast because now it's full of all type of light. It's all type of light associated to the podcast. Right now, the podcast like a little dark, like this shirt I got on, right? So nobody want to get involved in it. But when it get, according to the light on my logo, all of a sudden people want to actually find themselves in that space, right? And this is a time for you to remember and understand that this is your power shift. It belongs to no one else. As you go into this power shift, understand that this belongs to you and only you. It don't belong to no one else. It don't belong to no one religion, no one's God, no one's philosophy. It doesn't belong to any of those things. I'm saying this is a power shift, I'm saying, for self-fulfillment. And that self-fulfillment inadvertently transitions to others. Inadvertently, the fulfillment that you have for your life, what you do for your life, the power that you put into your life, the power that you build into your life, you inadvertently give it to others. You share with others because you realize something as you was growing that you didn't grow alone. When you really sit down and start paying attention to your growth, you realize that it was other people that was in your corner that invested in you, that put substance into you, that said something nice to you when everybody else put you down. And you probably never see that person again. You know what I'm saying? But understand that this thing that we call life is about a building model. Everything was built. The Bible talks about it was built. The Quran says everything was built. Everything was built. So we're living a life where we're responsible for building life and building the different models of life. And not just the things. The models of life that we are building is one another. It's us. We're the greatest value in the earth. There's no greater value in us in the earth. Anything that's in this earth is meaningless according to man. Man created all these things. All these things that you worship in, all these things that you talk about mean something. Man created all those things. Your car, your helicopters, your clothes, all that. Your medicine, all that. Your colleges and your schools and the this and your weapons and all that. Man is responsible for creating all these things. Animals don't create guns. Animals don't run around building up houses. Animals don't fix cars and airplanes. Animals do not make poison. Some animals are born with poison within them, but they do not make poisons. You know what I'm saying? They do not do it. Animals don't make cigarettes. You know what I'm saying? They don't transport weed from one location to the next location. You know what I'm saying? They're not in the poppy fields. You know what I'm saying? Picking the poppy seeds. You know what I'm saying? To sell across the board to other nations in the world, to overpopulate the world and crime. They're not doing that. They're not doing any of those things. This is man that's doing these things. Man's created all these living models and then running around acting like some fictitious entity created these things when he wanted to actually create all these things. All the harm and all the pain and all the suffering, man created all these different systems. And he created them against you. That's who he created them against. You. The power of you. I always say, I was born into a system that have multiple systems within side of systems, inside of systems. And I don't know what's the beginning of any one of those systems. None of those systems was created for me. All those systems created against me. I don't know nothing about none of those systems. When I go to school, the teacher is not breaking down the system they have according to their constitution, according to their government, according to the economical structure, according to their educational systems. No one's breaking down their systems. So your systems are not for me. How can your system be for me if I don't know your system in and out? Your system not breaking down to me, and then not pinpointed to me, and made explained to me as a child. How could you make the system for me? It's not for me. I'm a visitor on the system. I'm just bypassing on the system because regardless of what I do or not on these particular systems, it may be impossible for me to change those systems. So I can take my whole life and put it on a system and try to change a system that's looking to change me. It doesn't want to be changed. When I go to a nonprofit and they don't have certain tools and resources, they don't want to hear me say they don't have certain tools and resources. They want me to get down with the program that don't have any tools and resources and work without tools and resources. That's what they want me to do. Yeah, because this is the working model that they actually may have. Right? So when you're looking at the different systems that we have in, and what do those systems mean for our lives, how do they increase us? Besides the paycheck, besides you going to buy a house or car with the money that you accumulated for your services, what is the manifestation of you being employed in an organization? What is the manifestation of you giving your whole life up to follow this or to follow that? What gets you to the point where you say, you know what, man, I'm at peace and there's nothing in the world that could break my peace. I'm always going to be at peace. What does that for you? Nothing. We are insatiable, man. We always want, we want, and we want more because we are insatiable. It's actually a part of our biological makeup in some type of way, right? And there are many, you know, doctrines, information that actually solidifies that we, you know, we are insatiable, that we're not content with a lot of things that's in the world. And, you know, we want more a lot of time and then our fair share. So when we're looking at the power shift, that power shift is actually is created for you to go back into your own power, to find your own power in the world. Many people, places, and things, that power is out there for you to connect with, right? And it's to increase you. It's never to diminish you. If you go into spaces and you feel diminished and you feel depleted, that means that they're trying to diminish you and deplete you in those spaces. And the energy just doesn't lie. See, people can come to you with their words or they want to. Their words mean nothing. It's their energy that sells the whole story. If you look at their energy, right, you can see that they don't want you in the room. You can see that the concept that you hold near the heart, it doesn't resonate with them. So if it doesn't resonate with them, where is your power inside of that shift? If it doesn't resonate with them, where is it at? See, if you gotta find it, it's not there. You're supposed to already know where it's at. It's supposed to be coming to you every single day and connecting with you every single day. As long as you're a part of that regime, you're supposed to be increased and magnified. You know what I'm saying? Because you're here to bring forth your truth and to live your truth in these different spaces. And without understanding what that shift looks like, you know what I'm saying? Without really taking the time out to increase yourself, right? And to see your value in life, for you, nothing's going to take place for you. You could be locked into all these different things. You can make $1 million a year. $1 million a year is not going to make you happy. No, I never had $1 million a year, but I'm pretty sure it's not going to just make me happy just because I got $1 million a year. I might run into some weirdos if I got $1 million a year. You know, things might get real hectic for me if I got $1 million a year. I was reading an article, a young lady, she won like $60 million. And after a couple of years, she had basically told the news that when a lotto was the worst thing that ever happened to her. She said before she won a lotto, she had a very quiet and simple life. Her life wasn't full of making deals and contracts and this and that. She was able to go about her business. Nobody associated with money. No one knew her having anything. You know, she didn't have no unwanted visitors, no other things. How her life was just quiet. And one day she said, you know what? I want more excitement for my life. And I know how I'm going to get it. I'm going to play the lotto because I want some more excitement for my life. It would be amazing if I hit that money. Because no one plays the lotto unless they want to hit the number. No one. No one plays the lotto for free. They play the lotto so they can hit the lotto and use the money in lotto for whatever concept that they come up with about how to have a perfect life by hitting the lotto. So she hit the lotto, 60 million, super excited, right? And come back around a few years later and say, hit the lotto was the worst thing that ever happened to her. And then one of her family members killed her for the money, right? So when you're looking at this, right? And she's seen it, it was like writing this on the wall. She said, I'm going to die for this money. Because she had a lot of hardships over that money ever since she had that money. But she said before she got that money, she had no problems with nothing and nobody. Everybody in her family loved her. The community liked her. This and that. Now she's going out of block. She's like a movie star. She's like Will Smith at the Oscars, right? Everybody see her. Everybody know her. Everybody want to be a part of her, right? Everybody want to take this story and remake this story over and over again. So they also can be a part of the change of her power ship. They want to be a part of that ship too. They wanted money just like her. Then I guess they couldn't hit the number. You know what I'm saying? Probably only go to one person. The brand probably go to one person. More than one person, you know what I'm saying, hit it, they split it down the middle. So no one, still only go to one person, the grand prize. So you want it. If it's 60 million, only one person got to hit to get the whole 60 million. If not, it's going to get split down the middle, broken down. So understanding this, that you shifting into a new world, you want to do these new things for your life, but you got to realize that there are other things on the side of that spectrum that you don't pay attention to, and you don't even look at it. She never looked at the fact that she's going to get killed after she won $60 million. She said, my life is perfect. I have no more worries in the world. I can go buy me a Tesla, right? I can get me some stocks from X now, right? I can go to Barbados, you know what I'm saying? Even though I don't know nobody, I can just go there and just sunbathe. I ain't got to know nobody there, you know what I'm saying? The world loves strangers. I can just go and do whatever I want to do in the world because I got $60 million, right? And it wasn't true. All I'm saying is that there's nothing wrong with getting money. We all need money. I need money. Everybody know we all always going to need money. There's not a person on land that don't need money. Trump need money now. He still need money. He's a multi-millionaire for years or whatever. He still need money. He need money all the time. This is a part of our essence that we cannot change. We cannot change the fact that money is associated to this life. And we have used this money above the association of this life. This is what we have done. We have taken this money and we have made this money into our gods. This money has become our icons to look up to and to be a part of. I'm saying this is what we have done with this money. And we have taken man and we have placed man under the money, even though a man's face is on the money. We have still taken man and put him under the money, even though the money is associated with a man. Right? So when we come into this new way of life and you want to explore new things and you want to, you know, make more money, stuff like that. Yeah, that's cool. Look at your life. Look at what it is right now. Look at what it's going to be if this takes place. Look at how you can protect it from any harm that's going to come to you because of things that you achieve in life, right? Look at these things. And it's really important to look at them because it's a part of who you are. That shift of who you are, it can take you to the left, right? It can take you out of a good path. It can take you out of a dark path. No one want to be on a dark path. Even the men that run around talking about they in gangs and they gangsters and stuff like that, they don't want to be on a dark path either. They don't want to pay for the stuff that they do. They just want to do it. You know what I'm saying? Like a man hurt somebody and he go to court. Every time he go to court, he say not guilty, right? No man really goes in court the first time and say that he's guilty of a crime. No man wants to be punished, right? We find ourselves doing different things in the world. And we don't understand what those things are. We connect ourselves to people sometimes, and we don't know who those people are. And I want to share this story, and it's really important to me that 1 year, I came across this great idea, and I have found these headphones that I like. And I was like, you know, I'm going to take this headphone and I'm going to sell them, you know, and make a profit and stuff like that. So I want to find these headphones for like $1. And the headphones is like $140 something in the store. And my wife heard this story before too, because I told this story before too. But, you know, I found them for $1. It was $140 in the store. I was so excited. I was trying to get, you know, some more, you know, so I can continue on, you know, with this project I was working on. And I remember I was like walking down the block and I was like, I need somebody to help me, you know, with this project. I need an investor, you know. And I'm like, I went to a couple of people and I couldn't get the investors. And I come around the corner and I ran across this guy. I ain't seen him in a long time. I haven't seen him in over 20 something years. And my spirit said, yo, ask him, because he was the one, and check it out, this is amazing. He was the one that introduced me to crime when I was young. And I haven't seen him in over 20 something years. And I was looking for an investor for this product I had. And I ran around the corner and I ran into him. And I was like so, you know, taken aback because I haven't seen him in a long time. And, you know, we connect, we started talking, and he told me that he had sold his restaurant for over $100,000. And he didn't know what to do with the money. And I was like, well, you know, I got these headphones, and I showed it to him. I showed him where I got it from. I did everything. I was an open book to him. It's like, yeah, here you go. We can buy them for $1. We can sell them back for $20. We can wholesale them for $5. We'll make all our money back and more within 2 months, right? So I said, you invest $5,000, $10,000, whatever you want to invest. And I remember he saying that he didn't want to invest in it, even though he didn't supposedly have nowhere to invest his money at, but he didn't want to invest in that. I explained to him that this is a very great investment. I also said to him that you were the one that got me into crime when I was young, and I ran into you now as you know, as a young adult, we're adults, and now we can do business together as men, good business together as men, instead of the business that we was doing in the past, you know what I'm saying, you know, which was detrimental to society. So he still didn't understand that, you know, the same way he brought me into crime is the same way he could have came into business with me. He didn't see that. So he could see that it was easy for him to destroy my life, but not to increase it and not to improve it, right? And so this is what he left me with. When I left him, I was left with the notion that men would destroy one another's lives, but not build one another's lives up. This is what I was left with. And I didn't want to believe that, but it became true. It became true. About 2 weeks after I had that encounter with the individual, I got a phone call from his brother. His brother explained to me that the individual needed my help. He needed some money. I said, well, I don't have any money. I've been trying to do a business deal with your brother, and he didn't want to do it. I said, what's going on with your brother? He said, my brother's in prison. I said, I sent your brother like 2 weeks ago. He told me he had, you know, some money. He was working on some, he was trying to do something with the money, whatever. I said, I don't have no money for him. I don't know what he called me for. I said, he didn't want to do business with me at all. And I asked him, I said, well, you know, I'm kind of confused, man. I've seen your brother 2 weeks ago. He was doing good. You know, he just sold his restaurant, whatever. What is your brother locked up for? He said, yo, man, you know, my brother, you know, he had $100,000. I said, yeah, he was telling me $100,000, and he was trying to do some business with it. You know, he didn't want to do business with me, but I guess he did business somewhere else. He said, yeah, my brother went to go buy keys with the money and guns and got caught in a DA sting, and now he's in prison for trying to buy drugs and guns with the money that he accumulated from a legal restaurant business. So he went from a legal restaurant business into a legal drug trade. So he didn't want to do business with me because he wanted to take his money and invest it in a legal drug trade. And he wound up going to prison. And this is what I'm trying to show you. I seen a man like 7 years after that, and I didn't recognize the man. I grew up with the guy. When I saw him again, I didn't recognize him because the spirit of who he was to me, it was destroyed. I didn't recognize him spiritually because spiritually, My friend would never did nothing like that to me spiritually. To deny me, to do great business, to turn around and do business, to harm my people, and something that I actually came out of myself, and something he came out of himself, and for him to actually go back into that, right, to destroy his community and destroy other men and women, for he could be filthy, for he could be wealthy, you know what I'm saying, was astonishing. And my spirit forgot about him when he did that. And when I seen him again, I didn't recognize him. He had to tell me who he was, and I still didn't recognize him. Right? That's how profound this thing is. This is a power shift. When you're moving a power shift in your life, you know what I'm saying? Move into good spaces with good people that love you, that's going to care for you, that's going to cater to you. People that's not going to judge you because of your falls and your mishaps. You know what I'm saying? People not going to judge you for something that happened 40 years ago. You know what I'm saying? And 30 years ago that you didn't do this and you do that. Right? You want to be around people that's going to love you regardless of what it is you're going through in this time period. Right? And people that's going to hold you accountable for yourself. And it's going to make sure you do the things that you need to do to increase who you are in the land and not just them. You got people in the land that want you to increase them, but they will not increase you regardless of what it is that you do. You can take 90% of your time and invest in something, and they take 10% of their time, and they out of y'all equal, right? And y'all not. We got to both put 50% in for us to be equal and for us to move on the same synergy. You got to care for me the same way I care for you and vice versa. There is no big eyes and little U's when we actually dealing with this thing right here, especially in the spaces that I'm in. The spaces I'm in has no time for big eyes and little U's. Men and women are losing their lives every day on Rikers Island. Every week, every 2 months, who knows? Right? So at the end of the day, these things are not games for people to play with. And when we come into the land and we come into this new life and we start basically playing games and their system models that they have created, these models were not designed for us. These systems were not designed for us. Right? When we start playing with these things, we forget the reason why we came down here. All of us came out here with a certain mission. We came out with a certain agenda. But our agendas get swallowed up. Our missions get swallowed up with all these things out here we're trying to do. You come down here, you got to wear makeup because you're not beautiful. You know what I'm saying? You come out here, you got to change your body. You know what I'm saying? Because this body part is not ideal for the rest of the world. Like, how is it possible that over a billion people, a trillion people, all gonna like you? How is it possible? How is it possible that you could be born and everybody in the world gonna like you? That's impossible, man. It's not gonna happen. Everybody don't like everybody. There are certain stars out there I don't like. Other people say they like them. I don't like them. There's certain music out there I don't like. Right? So at the end of the day, how are you going to follow? How are you guys going to meet the image of the whole world? How are you going to do it? How are you going to fall in sync with how the whole world wants you to be? How are you going to do it? I'm listening. I sent the link out earlier, too. People could have tuned in anytime they wanted to, and they know that. But at the end of the day, this is what I'm trying to say. Tell me one person that everybody in the world love. One person. Tell me, as a woman, that when you walk down the block, every man that see you falls madly in love with you. Every man. And every man that see you wants to have you and needs you in their life. As a man, you're wealthy. You got money. Tell me that when you go down the block or you go into a party, that every woman on the block and in the party want to be with you. It's not true, man. You got $1 billion, a woman say she don't want to be with you. I was watching something a couple of months ago, they was talking about a man who was a multimillionaire, and the woman didn't want to be with him, so he committed suicide, right? And I was like, wow, I've never been a multimillionaire, and I haven't found a woman yet that I want to commit suicide for, right? And it's like, this is crazy, right? So at the end of the day, it's like, what is the model? What is your breaking point? What can you find in the land that's stronger than you? What can you find in the land that is more important than you? That has more purpose in you and more value than you? Who and what is it? As a man and as a woman, you're never, ever in this whole life is going to be loved by everybody. I don't care what your body part look like. I don't care what your face look like. I don't care if you got exquisite lips. You know what I'm saying? I don't care if you got the eyelashes of a century. It doesn't even matter, bro. I don't care if you got on these Chucks or you got on this $1,000 suit. It's not going to matter. You're never going to find a space in the world where everybody's going to love you in the world. So you can't come into this world expecting everybody to love you in the world and do things for people to love you in the world. You can't do it. You got to be who you are in this world for your own life. This is what you got to be. Because if you expect people to build you up, they're not going to build you up. If you expect people to find you, it's like if I talk to different men, you know what I'm saying? And I say, well, did you actually go find your friend when you made a lot of money? What do you mean? Did you go in the land and search for your friends when you came across money? Nah, man, I ain't do that. I want to bought me a car, so you went to go visit BMW before you went to go visit your friend. You went to go visit Gucci before you go visit your friend. You went to go visit Louis Vuitton before you went to go visit your friends, your mother, your sister, your brothers. You know what I'm saying? Your cousins in the land. You went and bought trinkets from the store and all that type of stuff before you went to see how your loved ones and your families are doing in the land when you came across a blessing. You ain't come back for none of them. But as soon as you need the strength of them, of their lives for your blessing, you're going to pick up the phone and call them and ask them to do something for you. You're going to tell me you're going to need a favor. But they didn't even know you had those blessings. You're not even going to tell me you had the blessings because you don't want to share your blessings, but you want to run around talking about you have blessed friends in the land, but you don't want to share none of your blessings. But you got friends. You got to be careful of these living models that's actually taking place around our lives, you know what I'm saying, all day, every day. People say they love you, but they won't tell you how much they love you by showing you the love of who they are. They won't bring you to the table and break certain things down to you, you know what I'm saying, and give you a deeper understanding, you know what I'm saying, and give you a deeper value for life. They won't challenge you when you do something weird, you know what I'm saying, and let you lose your life, but they say that they love you, but they don't, because they wouldn't let you do something weird to lose your life if they loved you, you know what I'm saying. At the end of the day, we have these working models, you know what I'm saying, that people try to fit themselves into, but we're not here to fit ourselves into anything. Nothing. There's no structure that man has created that you can fit into comfortably and just be satisfied completely. Where you can go to sleep for 1,000 years and say, nothing's bothering me. I'm at peace. Look at the laws. Look at the government. Look at the Constitution. Look at all the harmful organizations that's popped up all over the world to address the harm that people are doing to other people. And they call it systems, but it's people that created every system that exists on this plane. People created these systems. They didn't come out of thin air. So yeah, we make money for a lot of things. People make money for cigarettes. The cigarettes is bad for your health, but people die from cigarettes every year, and they make money over Oxycontin and all the other type of drugs. They make money off of these drugs. And then we call them wealthy, and they live in mansions and penthouses and all these different places like that we can't even enter, but we can go to the store and buy the drugs that they sell to us so they can live this prominent lifestyle, right? We can actually find ourselves like people like Epstein and stuff like that, the billionaire Epstein, to die in prison. Why would you want to be a billionaire to die in prison? Because of the harm that you were doing in the land against people that you're not supposed to be doing stuff against, because we all came here to live according to our power and not according to yours. If you run into people, and I make these posts all the time, if you run into someone, listen, guys, if you run into someone that's more powerful than you, run. I'm serious, man. I'm serious. Because no one should be exerting themselves to be as to be more powerful than you. No one. Everyone that you come around, you should be around, should be seeking for you to also find your power within that inner circle. And so you can also be powerful, and you can bring forth the change you need to bring forth according to your power. No one can tell you how to bring forth your power in the land according to your power, because no one has your power. With that, guys, I'm out of here. This is IAMTHEDATA. You know, love talking to you guys. Hope to connect with you guys further. Please subscribe to my channel, IAMTHEDATA, right? I'm on Google Podcasts, Amazon, iHeartRadio. I'm also on different type of social medias, YouTube, IAMTHEDATA. Subscribe. It allows me to continue what I'm doing. And I'm always looking to interview people, to connect. Let me know, man. I'm here for your story. This is about IAMTHEDATA. It's about leadership and the development and coming to your true purpose. And with that, guys, blessings. Be well.